Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, good whatever time it is, wherever you're at. We're just happy you're listening. Thanks for all the amazing downloads, over 200 downloads of What the Cup of Podcast thus far. We appreciate all of you guys out there listening. We're happy that hopefully you're learning a little bit of something, learning about some people, or at least just enjoying DaPrato showing off his small little arms and big pecs. Today, we have a very special guest for episode 8, Sue Falsone. She's a PT, an athletic trainer, an SCS, a CSCS. She's got all the letters. She's pretty much the guru when it comes to sports. She was the first female head athletic trainer out of any of the four major sports in the United States. She was the head athletic trainer and physical therapist for the LA Dodgers for 6 years. We won't hold that against her. Head of athletic training and sports performance with U.S. Soccer Men's National Team. And she's the owner of Structure and Function Education. This is a company dedicated to educating healthcare professionals in techniques such as dry needling and cupping, as well as how to clinically bridge the gap from rehab to performance. She recently authored a book with the name Bridge the Gap from Rehab to Performance. You can find it on Amazon, along with your $600 order of hand sanitizer and toilet paper. So sit back, relax, and enjoy the smooth conversation about fascia and sports and athletes and all of the above in the healthcare world with episode 8 of What the Cup, a podcast with Sue Falsone. Today's podcast is brought to you by cuptherapy.com. Want to learn science-based application of negative pressure treatments? Want to know more about the in-depth research being done at the University of California, San Francisco? Want to take your clinical skills to the next level? Check out www.cuptherapy.com for more information on the original movement-based, evidence-informed myofascial decompression techniques used by clinics around the world, professional teams, and Olympians. That's www.cuptherapy.com.
All right. So welcome back. This is episode 8, flying by so many so fast. This is what we do in quarantine time because we're bored, basically. And I'm here with a great guest. This is Sue Falsone. You know, you are well known throughout all the rehab. Most of the people watching this are either physios, athletic trainers, or other soft tissue practitioners. So this is our audience that's going to be super fascinated with the things that you've done, both bridging gaps, like we were going to talk about rehab into performance, but also I think some of the disparities in the culture of the sports medicine world and some of the things that you've done there. So I'm really looking forward to having these conversations and again, wrapping the big kind of umbrella topic of fascia around it all. So tell us
I'm
how you're doing.
Thanks for having me.
I'm super excited. So I met Sue here in 2018 in Berlin for the first time. I had, talked to other athletic trainers. I worked with the A's back in 2011, 2012, and they talked highly about you, doing the early myofascial decompression stuff. And so I've heard lots of things, talked about lots of great subject matter when it comes to fascia, but now I get to actually, talk to you in a conversation here.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it. Gosh, Berlin feels like a lifetime
ago. It's so long ago. Yeah, so long ago. So tell us just a quick brief intro into like your background, but also how fascia entered your world. When did that happen?
Yeah, that's a great question. Before I get into any of that, I'm going to preface this with I have a sick dog right now at the house. He has a little bit of energy to him right now, so you might hear a squeaky toy. I'm going to try but I want to encourage him to play. So anyway.
Entertain away. Yeah.
Yes. This is the life of Zoom meetings, right? Is dealing with animals in the background. So
another type of bridging. Absolutely. No, no problem at all. So yeah, we're excited to hear.
Yeah. So, it's so funny because we like to kind of talk about like fascia, like it's this new thing, right? And like, as we know, this has been a tissue that has been around since the beginning of time, and this is not a new tissue. And I love the resurgence of it, and like, or I should say just the surgence of it, right? That people are talking about it and it's like a thing now. But yeah, gosh, I mean, fascia's been in my life forever, as it is for all of us.
Yeah, whether we like it or know it or not, right? Right. Yeah, absolutely. So I think especially in the last 10 years, it's been a buzzword almost. And without people really wrapping their heads around both the biomechanical aspects of it, but also some of the neurophysiologic aspects as well, and how it really kind of tethers these systems together. Tell me, maybe before Berlin, what was your awareness of some of the literature out there, or some of the things that you were exposed to and made you want to go to Berlin to begin with?
Yeah, I had, gosh, where did I meet Robert Schleif? Robert and I, so I was speaking at a conference in Montabaur, Germany. With a group called Arts, and they're a supply company in Germany. And so I used to speak for them almost annually for 3 or 4 years, I guess, in Montabaur. And so Robert was speaking at the same conference. And so that's where we were introduced, and we got along, and just spent time with each other, which was really cool. And he obviously presented on fascia.
Oh, yeah.
That was really my, I think, first time getting to know him, I should say.
Yeah.
And he gave me his book, which I thought was super kind and super sweet.
Awesome.
And so, yeah, read his book and really had the opportunity to learn more about his work. And then he invited me to come to Ulm and speak at the conference, which, again, was also really cool. So then just being
awesome.
Being able to go and hear everybody kind of talking about fascia and their research,
totally.
Just such an amazing opportunity.
Yeah, and again, like, we scratched the surface, I think, in physical medicine rehabilitation and sports medicine in general, and it's such a huge encompassing area of research, and I think understanding, or the lack of understanding, and some of the things that we're trying to perceive with both, again, the neural system and the biomechanical aspects of the musculoskeletal system. Yeah, Robert is amazing. I mean, he's been producing literature since the 1990s. Really a kind of a typical practitioner of the arts with his hands, that manual therapist to a T, where he has his, braid down the back and, the long flowing hair, and just like one with the earth and the world of the universe all around him at all times.
Yeah.
He's kind of quintessential, but also very bright human, and, love reading his work that he's done.
Yeah. Uh-oh. Yeah. He's got a great soul to him too. And
oh, yeah.
So it, matches, just brings everything to, his personality into his research and into his writing and into his work. And so, yeah, it was just an honor to get to know him. And if you haven't read his work or seen him, definitely look up Robert Schleif. You will have a lot of articles and a lot of books.
Tons. So much. Yeah, the last 20 years basically filled with it. And so it's great. So tell me, we were lucky enough to present our material at the conference in Berlin on the International Fascial Congress, which happens every 3 years. The next one's next year, 2021, in Montreal. Tell us what you took away from that conference, because it was, again, 3-day amazing gathering of researchers from around the world presenting things that they found fascinating, or hashtag fascinating, right, on fascia and all the things that come with that. So what did you see when you were there?
Yeah, being able to go to the conference in Berlin was really, really cool, just to see how the researchers across the world are really diving into this topic. And, we work really closely with Antonio Stecco. So my education company, Structure and Function Education, is a provider of fascial manipulation education with the Stecco. So we work quite closely with Antonio and the Stecco Institute as a whole. And so, being able to listen to Carla, listen to Antonio, listen to a lot of these people who are just living in this fascinating world every day is really, really cool. And I think, it's just some big takeaways that I always try to share with our students and with people, is that, superficial fascia is innervated, which means it's a pain generator. And that's a really interesting thing. I just was having a call with one of my doctoral students, and she's got a patient who, she's kind of struggling with. And so we were going over some things, and she was like, I was giving her some ideas to think about. And she said, I totally get the nerve stuff, but we did an EMG and an NCV and it was negative. I'm like, okay, great. that's awesome. That tells me that the nerve is healthy, but that does not tell me if there's some entrapment in the superficial fascia.
Yeah.
Because that can be, whenever I get a negative EMG or an NCV, I immediately think fascia, because those things aren't going to show up, right? So totally. I think that's really good to realize. And then with my strength and conditioning people, I always talk about too, that deep fascia is a force transmitter. And yeah. I think that's a really important piece of information as it relates to plyometric training. I don't think it's going to change that we do plyometrics. We have done plyometrics for a long time, and we will continue to do plyometric training for a long time to come. But I think it's going to change our why. You know, we've been so wrapped up in amortization phases and couple times, eccentric and concentric contraction of muscles. But really, come to find out, the deep fascia plays a huge role in how we transfer force and probably plays a huge role in how we coach and do plyometrics. So, you know, for me, those two things, I think, were and continue to be big take-home messages for me as I talk about fascia.
Yeah, I think you hit two really important points there, that you have this nociceptive pain, this like superficial signaling to the central nervous system that resides highly in that dermal layer, right? That superficial fascial membrane or the tissues within that. And that's all that neurophysiologic stuff that we talk about. But then you have this other biomechanical aspect of that deep fascia, right? Force transmission, and where almost 30% of your forces come sometimes from the antagonist of what you think is acting on a certain actual agonist movement pattern. And I think like one of the struggles I have, like I'm teaching at the DPT level, right? And so we're in courses where people are learning manual muscle tests and goniometric, you know, measurements. And how do you get the traditional physio out of the world of manual muscle test specific, you know, focus and into this idea of movement patterns instead of MMTs? I don't think we're there yet. I think it's super challenging as a whole.
Yeah, that's a really great, great thing. I think, you know, we were just talking about, I just had a meeting with my colleagues at AT Still University. So I also teach in the doctorate of athletic training program at AT Still University. And one thing that our program director, Eric Sowers, was just presenting to our graduate students is this concept of AT milestones and how, you know, everyone thinks like, okay, you pass your entry level exam and everybody thinks like, okay, now you're the expert, right? Where really, if you sort of look at it, like in medical school, okay, you pass medical school, you're at like a level one, right? And then you do your residencies, then you move to the next level, and then you do your fellowships,
level, right? Yeah.
Then, you know, like it takes all of this time. And
decades.
So I think, it takes decades, right, to become a master practitioner. And so when I think of things like manual muscle testing and these sorts of things, I think they are really, really important for our students to learn.
Yeah.
Sorry, I'm letting my dog out.
Yeah,
so sorry
not
if
a
I'm
problem.
Making you dizzy as I'm moving.
Not a problem, not a problem.
So I think these things are really important at that foundational level, because I think if you don't have an appreciation for manual muscle testing and, you know, this muscle runs from here to here, like it's hard to start to break the rules if you don't understand the rules.
Understand the rules, absolutely, yeah.
So I do think these fundamental concepts of manual muscle testing and tissue stress testing and how we sort of deal with all of these things at the entry level is still important.
Yeah.
It doesn't negate it, but we do have to give the message of this is the beginning. There's more to this. This fits into a bigger picture. This isn't the be all end all. You know, there is something bigger here. And
Absolutely.
That's the message I think that's missing in entry level education.
I totally agree. Yeah. And, you know, I can go so many tangents based on what you said right now. And just, it's such a rabbit hole of, how do you, and again, a lot of the listeners here are also students or students at DPT or getting into DPT programs or other, you know, again, soft tissue providers. How do you get that driven, you know, analytical brain that's academically focused to take a small step away from the academics to appreciate the other parts of patient-centered, you know, healthcare? AKA, like, how do we get some of these people that are now, I think, polarizing the profession with pain science, and no manual therapy at all, and try to bridge their gaps of, you know, there's a time and a place for all things. And we all know that intuitively and naturally, But when you talk about, again, I'm at a medical school that has a very rigorous research component to it and lots of funding that touts evidence-based practice. How do we take and appreciate the other components of it that aren't yet evidence-based, right? Because it takes time and money. I know very well after going through the last 5 years of trying to get things, you know, scientifically understood and published that the research world is not what you think it is. And so how do you bridge that gap for people that are coming out, you know, doughy-eyed and like, you know, full of energy that say, everything I've read for the last 3 years says manual therapy doesn't work and you guys are full of crap. I know that's a lot.
Yeah, this is a fun conversation.
Yeah.
Yeah, that is a great question. I mean, I always go back to, you know, of course, it's about the nervous system, right? Like, we know that. We know yeah. that from a movement standpoint. It's the sensory motor system for a reason, right? Like, there's the sensory Correct. Component, there's the motor component.
Yeah.
You can't have muscles without nerves.
Absolutely.
So we know that the brain obviously plays a huge role in that. But yeah, like, you can't take the physical out of physical therapy. And
yeah, true.
I've been doing, I had to present, I've presented this at a couple places now. Well, where did I present this? Oh, I know. I had to do like a low back pain session for the BOC for NATA last
yep.
year. So, you know, I had to kind of comb the research. And I think that when we look at the literature on manual therapy, maybe it's not working the way we think it works, meaning mm-hmm. maybe we're not following or changing the arthrokinematic biomechanical thing the way we think we're changing it, right? Like, there's a very interesting study. If we think about biomechanics, okay, if you externally rotate your shoulder, we know biomechanically that there's a roll and glide that occur there. So, right, mm-hmm. you roll posteriorly, we glide anteriorly. Well, and they looked at, you know, I can't remember the authors, but they basically looked at, okay, people who have frozen shoulder, we'll do an anterior joint mobilization at the shoulder. And then with some people, we'll do a posterior joint mobilization and see who gets better.
Yeah,
well, sure totally. Enough, the people who got the posterior shoulder joint mobilization got more external range of motion, which biomechanically doesn't make any sense.
None at all.
So, but yet, right, we know that manual therapy works, right? There's multiple examples like this. So manual therapy works. It just maybe doesn't work the way we think it works. And maybe we're influencing the nervous system way more than we're possibly influencing the biomechanical
yeah,
system.
Absolutely.
It's something to kind of think about and consider. I don't think we should be tossing manual therapy out the window,
but
I think we need to be evaluating, okay, it probably isn't doing all the things that we think it's doing, but what is it really doing?
Or thought it was doing when we learned male-female rule. Like, I mean, like, that was the stuff I learned way back when. And like, we can see that that doesn't really hold much water anymore. And so, you know, I think don't throw the baby out with the bathwater type of thing is
That's
what
right.
it comes down to again. And for me, it's always this idea of 80-20, like 80% of the changes are probably neurophysiologic, but you can't discount some of the things that do happen mechanically over time. And being able to measure that just takes time and technology. And maybe we're just not there technology wise.
100%. I mean, think of all the stuff with diagnostic ultrasound now.
Exactly. Yeah.
That come out. Whereas, you know, 10 years ago, we weren't even looking at diagnostic ultrasound. And when you know, I do a lot of work and studying in Europe, or at least I did pre-COVID.
Yeah.
And when you look at, you know, how they're utilizing musculoskeletal ultrasound, they looked at me like I was crazy in the fact that like every clinic in the US doesn't have.
Yeah. In their clinical practice. Absolutely. Especially with cost. I mean, it's come down in cost so much. And I think technology as it advances, you have to adapt to this newfound ability to have better information to provide, not just to your other, you know, students, but to your patient, you know, because some people have that linear kind of, I think, approach to wanting to get better, that they want to see the objective measures. But if those objective measures don't fit their subjective experience, they're not going to care. But you have to kind of pair the two together in my practice most of the time is what I found.
Yeah, that stuff is so important. And I think that you're right. Like some of our technology, right? Like we're just learning how to measure stiffness within fascia, right? And so we know there are changes in the stiffness. We know, like you and I both utilize obviously a lot of cupping. And so we see that there are biomechanical changes and what those biomechanical changes are and how we can affect stiffness of tissue. Really, really interesting. So you're 100% right. There's definitely a biological component to what's happening. We just have to continue to explore. Yeah. I think these polarizing opinions of manual therapy does nothing. It's all about the nervous system. There's nothing biomechanical. It's all like these polarizing statements are, I think we know better.
And it doesn't really help anyone along the way. I think we're all trying to figure it out. Nobody has all the answers. And, you know, I just find it, especially in this new Instagram world that I've gone down the last 3 years, it's really frustrating to see these polarizing individuals that get such attention. And then some of my students come in and they say, well, this other stuff is full of crap because, you know, this literature piece and this literature piece, and, you know, they can stand on these foundations of literature, but I don't know about some of these people that come out as experts 1 or 2 years out of school, and they're touting all these things, right? And you have no experiential knowledge to really drive some of those decision-making clinical reasoning factors for you. And I find it hard to have people that have only been practicing for a year say, this is the way it is. And I think that's, unfortunately, some of the effects of these polarizing, you know, Instagram gurus that are out there.
Yeah, unfortunately, right? You don't have to put your whole CV on your Instagram
profile. Yeah.
So, you know, unless you really do your homework, you don't really know what people's backgrounds are. And it was funny, as I was listening to, you know, Eric talk this morning about these 18 milestones and how you kind of move through, you know, up to this, what they call this concept of mastery. You know, I wanted to chime in and be like, do you want to talk about how you like go after you hit what, or you think hit mastery, how you like go back to the, like, I feel like I'm in the phase right now where I don't know anything.
Yeah, right? Exactly. Like, because you revisit it all.
I'm like, I feel like I need to just retire. Like there's too much. I can't wrap my brain around it.
It's anymore. Daunting sometimes. The more you know, the more you learn, you don't know jack.
100%.
Unfortunately, very frustrating at times.
Yeah, 100%. And I think when you have people who are saying they have all the answers, I just always question those people because, you know, I've got a lot of experience behind me and I know I am nowhere near having all of the answers.
Yeah. I was like, I'm not the master yet. I'm still going 20 years into like trying to figure it all out. Yeah. It's hard, you know, and I try to bridge it all. I was a strength coach going through PT school and like, NSCA material was my foundation. Right. And so I applied it all from there. And then I found this wonderful world of manual therapy. I was like, well, why don't we do both? And that's always been my mindset. But, you know, I think some of the ideas of like literature has driven away some of this really valuable concept of manual therapy and how it does affect the nervous system.
And, you know, and I think too, to like kind of keep going down that path for a minute, like, this concept of evidence-based medicine does also include patient values and clinician experience.
Right?
And so I don't know why those two pieces of the puzzle get ignored. And then on top of that, what also gets ignored is if it's not a systematic review or a meta-analysis, people act like there's no research. Whereas we know, like in my world, there is no randomized controlled trial on 7-foot-tall NBA players.
Absolutely.
So, I have to look at a case study or a case series to help answer my questions. So it's the best available evidence. And sometimes the best available evidence we have is a case study.
Absolutely.
And that's okay. You know, I like the new movement back to the case study and case series. I think that's really cool and way more clinically relevant. I think when we start to do these double blind controlled trials, you have to eliminate so many factors that it becomes not relevant.
Such a small population. Yeah. It's so narrow. Yeah. I mean, I'm lucky enough, like I'm at the NCAA level with Cal and like, there's a couple papers out there on collegiate baseball players or a collegiate, you know, this, that, or the other for shoulder or for, you know, back pain or whatever it is, but it's so far and few between that I still can't apply it necessarily to this female team because this male team had a literature, you know, review on something. Doesn't mean I can apply it to all the different athletes I see. It's such a hard way to design studies to make them as specific as possible and narrow down the variables to hopefully one, which is impossible most of the time, but also, you know, just kind of what that is. And you have to take the whole encompassing thing. And I think people get lost in that translation because there's so much information out there now.
Completely agreed.
Enjoying the conversation so far? We are too, but let's take a stretch break. It's been a while. Stand up. Reach around. Touch your toes. Grab your keyboard. Go to www.cuptherapy.com and check out the newly designed website, including the links to our brand new online didactic level one course for myofascial decompression. Also, we're beginning to reintroduce a few level two classes, so feel free to check out the schedule and see if we're coming into a city near you in the next few months. Enjoy the rest of the conversation with Sue Falsoni.
Yeah, tell me maybe who were your big influencers in the idea of manual therapy, and specifically dry needling and cupping, if you want to get more specific.
Yeah, you know, I have from a dry needling perspective, you know, I learned needling and cupping 10 years ago from Yan Tao Ma. And so, you know, he obviously had a huge influence on my practice. You know, now I do a lot of studying in England with the, I always want to say the American, and I'm like, nope, it's not the American. With the Association of Acupuncture for Chartered Physiotherapists.
Yeah.
Yep. And then obviously a lot of stuff in Italy with the Stecos, and then some stuff in Spain surrounding percutaneous nerve stimulation with dry needling. And then actually doing some Chinese medicine stuff through a university in Hong Kong. And so, you know, just kind of expanding out from there to just sort of like continue to try to learn and expand on all of these concepts. And, you know, as we, that phrase sort of bridging the gap fits so many things in my life.
Because
I'm like bridging the gap from rehab to performance. I'm bridging the gap from Eastern and Western medicine. I'm bridging the gap, right? Like cupping has been around for, gosh, for thousands of years. And people want to argue with me in, you know, whatever it is, 200 characters on Twitter. I'm like, look at, there's five things that have been around for thousands of years. Needles, right? I don't care what you want to call it. Acupuncture, dry needling, doesn't matter. Like
whatever.
Needling, cupping has been around for thousands of years. Gua sha, so instrument assisted, has been around for thousands of years. Yoga, and if you think about yoga, the asanas, basically, or movement, right? So like a movement practice. And then within yoga too, like their breath-based meditation, right? So it's like, how do you connect the mind and the body? So like when you really look at it, to me, needles, cups, instrument-assisted, movement, breath and meditation, and mind, and how we connect the mind and body, it's really hard to refute things that have been around for thousands of years. Just because we don't know why they work, doesn't mean they don't work. It just means we're still working out why they work.
Absolutely.
So people want to start kind of throwing all these new and fancy tools at me. I'm like, that's cool. Like you can spend your time wherever you want from a learning perspective. But it's really hard to say that cupping or needling is stupid when it's been around for thousands of years.
Yeah, and again, it's like, are you choosing the right tool for the right situation is what it comes down to. But you're right. And it transpires all different cultures, not just Chinese medicine, right? It's so many different cultures. One of the things that I found out, you know, early on was this whole idea of hijima or wet cupping, right? And so the whole bleeding aspect, and for a totally different reason with different mechanisms and different approach styles, right? And so this negative pressure device is used all across different cultures, all across different medicines for different reasons. And I think you just need to pull the tool out of your toolbox when that thing is appropriate, whatever it may be, and not necessarily try to shoot down all the tools that people have in their boxes. I think you can challenge when they bring the wrong tool out, clinical reasoning wise, whether it's nervous system or actually biomechanical or biologic tissues, right? Is the tissue the issue? But you really kind of got to go back to the toolbox. Like, there's nothing wrong with having a lot of tools. You just have to use them when they're appropriate, right?
100%. I mean, so many times, you know, I'm the 6th, 7th, 8th, 9th practitioner that my client has seen. So they already have, right? And this is where it comes back down to that concept of patient belief system, right? If they come into me and say, oh, I've done needling, I've done cupping, I've done this, I've done that, none of that's worked. Well, then I better have another tool in
something
my
else. Yeah.
that I can try.
Even if you're the best at those other things, yeah.
That's right. Or somehow convince them that maybe there's a different technique, right? Because they already have a negative perception that that tool didn't help them. So yeah, I'm a big fan of having a lot of tools in the toolbox because you never know, but you're 100% right. People, it's amazing to me when I ask clinicians what their philosophy is surrounding rehab and treatment. Like people say, oh, well, you know, I follow LMNOP, right? Like pick whatever favorite letters that you can use. And I'm like, okay, but like, what is that philosophy, right? Like my philosophy for treating a patient is to restore and maintain the homeostatic balance of my client. That's it. So whether that's biomechanical, bioneural, biohormonal, biopsychosocially, I want to restore and maintain the homeostatic balance of my patient. That's it. As long as I continue to come back to my philosophy, the tool, it doesn't matter. I can choose a hammer. I could choose a screwdriver, right? Like you said, you need the appropriate tool for the appropriate job. Totally. But I come back to my philosophy. And what I find, especially with younger clients or younger clinicians, is that they mistake tools for philosophy. And that's where people get in trouble.
Yeah. Yeah. Because you get mixed up really quick because there's going to be 10 different approaches to using that tool. Right. I don't think we're the first to combine cupping with movement science, but in 2007 at Cal, we started using a lot and we were looking at the literature and like, this didn't exist very much. I'm sure lots of people had done it for hundreds of years, thousands of years. They put some cups on and said, well, move your shoulders and feel better. Yeah. But we were the first to actually, you know, try to systematically do an approach that made sense biomechanically and neurophysiologically. But like, you're right. It's all these different things. And you got to understand that the basis of all that is your foundations. And I think a lot of people skip the basics and go right to the advanced things. And they don't understand that those foundations are going to totally change the way you use that tool if you're using your clinical reasoning the appropriate way. And I think it's fascinating to see those types of things. Let me ask you a question I get a lot is, I used to practice in Colorado. And so ADO and kinetic core was kind of the way I was introduced to dry needling. When would you usually pull the needle out instead of pull the cup out? Taking out, again, the patient preference always runs, you know, primo. That's the first thing. But when do you like to use a needle over a cup or a cup over a needle for yourself?
Yeah, I that's a great question. And I'm going to use a very, I'm going to answer that in a couple different ways. For me, needling, I use needling in such a broader way now that I have a little bit more and I know I'm not supposed to say the A word, but considering the A word, I know. Yeah. But I have taken acupuncture courses in the UK and in Italy and in Spain, and I know that that means nothing here in the US, so I'm not claiming that I'm an acupuncturist. But as you start to learn a little bit more about the broader sense and application of needles beyond that of the musculoskeletal system, my application for needles is way broader than like a tendinosis or a tendinopathy or a trigger point at this point in my career. So I use needles a lot from a recovery regeneration standpoint, from a balancing the autonomic nervous system standpoint, and from a pain control standpoint. And specifically if people say, you know, okay, my pain is here, then okay, like a needle is appropriate. When that pain is here, cupping is probably more appropriate, right?
More like I totally agree.
Yeah, like you could put a needle in someone's IT band, absolutely, but I feel like I get better usage of a cup, right? Absolutely. And trying to work the tissue between the IT band and the vastus lateralis, the IT band and the hamstring. Versus like putting one little needle lesion there. Yeah. So I think the issue's broader, I tend to use a cup.
Totally agree. And either of them, I think, give you that opportunity to, after decreasing that irritability, teach him to move more efficiently, right? And that's that glue. That's the thing that people, again, when you learn in isolation a technique, you forget that movement and efficiency and being a, you know, optimally functioning human is the end goal at the end of the day.
100%. And I think that's what people always forget too. Like, again, when people want to argue about needling, it's like, the goal is not to put needles in people. That's not my goal. My goal is to make them move better. My goal is to make them return to their function better. That's always the goal. As long as you have that goal in mind and again, apply your tool appropriately to support your path to that goal.
Totally.
And that's great. But yeah, the goal isn't to, you know, stick cups on people or to stick needles in people. That's never
in the
goal.
Yeah. Yeah. To move better. And I don't know about you. I mean, I've been doing this like 16 years now. And I found that the longer I practice, the more I get a broader sense of the effects of the things I'm doing, and not such a, like, I also teach a lot of manipulation, and like, okay, a CT junction, I'm getting, you know, T1 to go that way while stabilizing this, and I'm trying to get the, and then you're thinking so micro and so of this like little specific effect, and is the cavitation appropriate or important for range of motion changes? And I used to, you know, read the literature and think no, but now I'm thinking like on a global level, the more I practice, the more I feel like you're treating this whole human and not C7 on T1. And it's just kind of the way, I think when you learn your skills and you're a young clinician, it's hard to separate away from this idea of this affects this directly, A plus B equals C. And it's not, so like A plus B plus D plus P equals X, Y, and Z. And like, yeah, you have to understand that it's not a linear component of it all. And you step, I think as you gain more of that mastery or getting close to that mastery, you step away and you realize that all the things function together. It's like, you know, how do you feel about like that idea of that specific intervention affecting a bigger thing?
I think you're 100% right. And you start off with this myopic view of, right, yeah, like, yeah, I'm going to fix that joint.
Yeah.
And we know that, like, okay, yes, maybe that joint is a component of it. But like, again, I try to remind people that just because you like the musculoskeletal system doesn't mean you can be arrogant enough to think that that's the only thing you're going to affect. So, yeah, you know, I kind of use the example, I use that example with needles a lot, but like as you, it relates to manipulation, you know, I tell people from a thoracic manipulation standpoint, yeah, I'm all about a thoracic manipulation if that's what somebody needs, but what lives in the thoracic spine, right? We have the posterior mediastinum and we have sympathetic ganglia. So I'm all about doing a high velocity manipulation to someone's thoracic spine pre-game or pre-practice if that's what's needed. But to do that and then ask them to go to bed,
yeah,
that's probably really not smart, right? Because I'm stimulating their sympathetic nervous system. So if I'm doing treatments at night post-game, I probably want to try to get thoracic mobility through deep breath and deep movement, yeah, and try to stimulate vagus nerve and try to do a little bit more, you know, some different techniques that wouldn't be as sympathetically stimulating.
Yeah.
Because we have to remember every time we apply a technique, just because I like muscles, tendons, ligaments, and bones doesn't mean that everything else is out the window. Viscera is going to be affected, nervous system is going to be affected. So how is my technique having a broader application across the board?
Yeah, I think that's so fundamental, especially for the needle. Like that one needle going into that one extensor group on the forearm, you know, is going to have grand effects all the way into the cervical spine, into the thoracic spine, and then how that nervous system feels. And again, it's one of those things when you teach young clinicians, for you young clinicians out there, or, you know, even students out there, remember you're treating the whole thing and this little piece of the puzzle fits in, but it's not the puzzle. It's not the picture. It's a piece of that picture and things. Yeah, that's great. I love this conversation. Let's go into how, now that we're talking about teaching, how is this newfound environment of COVID and online education, how does it affect, you think, the next 5 years of teaching our, you know, soft tissue providers and manual therapists out there?
It is, you know, I have been, this is where my brain has been for the last 5 months. How do we teach people manual therapy skills? How do we teach them, you know, an invasive technique like dry needling? You know, what things really need to be done in person versus what things could probably be done in an environment like we're doing right now? And yeah, you have to ask yourself some really hard questions to say, okay, what can be delivered in this manner versus what needs to be delivered in person? Let's face it, we are in medicine. No one is gonna wanna go to a surgeon who's never performed surgery on someone learned all the surgical techniques via Zoom.
Online,
You know, there is a component to this that has to remain in person. That's just how it is. I feel passionate about that. Can I make that more efficient? I think absolutely. I think there's lectures and things and interactive things that we can do online with each other. to make our time in person more efficient.
Absolutely.
But I think that in person, you know, again, I'm not going to the doctor who did online medical school.
That's fair.
And I would encourage you not to either.
Yeah. No, I agree. I went into this online thing kicking and screaming back in February, because I'm like, no, manual therapy needs to be in person. You need that kinesthetic learner. That's who we are most of the time, to learn kinesthetically. And I was kicking and screaming that we finally converted it into a level one, which is all online now, and a level two, which is all in person now. Because, you know, you got to keep your brains fresh too. We have to keep going, even though we're in this kind of like a little bit of a staleness when it comes to in-person education. But I agree, like you want someone that's done that tactile learning, that kinesthetic learning, to be the one to manipulate your C7i or T1, or stick that needle into that, you know, intercostal muscle, or all the things that you need a little bit more refining as you go through the learning process of it, you know, some of these skill-based activities and things. Yeah. It is interesting. It's a whole new world, though. It's fascinating to me, for sure.
It really is. And like you, I mean, we luckily had started our online platform last year. And so we got things up and running pretty quickly in March. And so, yeah, I really like our online stuff. And like I said, we're offering, or we're going to be offering moving forward, a new hybrid model as well for people who, you know, can take, if they've already taken a dry needling class.
Like, yeah, absolutely.
There's other ways that we can kind of begin to work together. So, you know, we're keeping an open mind, like you said. Yeah. I mean, I think we were super anti, you know, at first as well, but it's making us take a real hard look at efficiency. Totally. And making sure that our time together is really dialed in and locked in. We're doing the same thing.
Yeah. I mean, like, I've sent all of our training staff at Cal to your classes for dry needling when they can come and do them. And, you know, I think there's, if anyone's out there is looking for dry needling, the structure and function model, I think, fits really well. I'm in California, so I haven't had the time to get out there and take one of your classes. Again, I was influenced by the ADO and Kinetic Core in the past, but I hear nothing but good things. So if you guys are looking for dry needling out there, check it out. And again, Structure and Function also offers online education in both dry needling, Bridging the Gap, I think, soon, and then Cupping Introduction as well. So lots of information on Sue's platform there and things like that. All right, let's finish off with something fun. You've been doing this a long time. I think, you know, my last podcast I did with is an orthopedic surgeon at UCSF that's a female, and all the kind of diversity and all the disparity and the things she had to overcome to get to where she is. And, you know, she's a Team USA provider for Taekwondo and went to London Games. And, you know, we went through a great conversation, some of these things. And you've also, again, to use that metaphor, bridging the gap for females in athletic training and in sports medicine, you've done some great things and you've pioneered some things. What is your next step after going through all the amazing stuff that you've done? Is it more education? Is it mentorship? A big thing that came up last time was mentorship. I think for a lot of females in the sports medicine world, how do you get to those higher positions and climb that ladder? Or what are some recommendations that you may have, or things that you want to do with your career for the next, you know, hopefully 15 or 20 years that you're still enjoying practicing and whatnot, or educating? What do you see yourself doing? You've done it all.
Yeah.
This actually comes from, you know, Chris Garcia down at Chula Vista. He was with
Team USA. Oh, yeah, of course.
He says, oh, Sue's done it all. Just ask her, what's next? How do you continue? Chris.
Yeah, that's a great question. And I think probably something all of us are asking ourselves during this time of COVID, right? Like, what is the meaning of my life? Where am I headed? What am I doing next?
Sure.
You know, that's a great question. I think at this stage in my career, you know, I still have a clinical practice. I have a concierge practice, so I treat athletes weekly. And I love treating athletes. I'm really passionate about education over the last probably 3 to 5 years of my career. I think, you know, I have 5 patients. You know, when you have a concierge practice, you don't have 30 patients, right? Because it's midnight, it's 6 a.m, it's travel. It can be
for better or for worse.
For better or for worse, that's right. It's a very high time attention kind of a gig, right? So you know, when you think about it, it's like, okay, I can affect those 5 people, or I can affect the 30 patients times 100 people in the room, right? Like, and all of a sudden, you know, now you're affecting 3,000 patients. through education. So I'm super passionate about education. And, you know, I do love being able to work and teach and educate and talk with athletic trainers, physical therapists, and strength coaches. And really helping those three, and now trying to bring in the acupuncturists too. Like,
yeah,
there's such a great,
it's huge,
interdisciplinary Eastern
resource.
And Western.
They're a great resource.
Yeah, totally. Huge, amazing resource. And so, yeah, I really am passionate about bridging that gap and kind of having everybody respect and understand those things. You know, I definitely can tell I'm getting older in my career because, like, I'm starting to be asked to do, like a chapter in a leadership book and, like, a chapter in, like, a women book about kind of breaking the glass ceiling with a lot of different women, which hopefully we'll be able to kind of put out information on that stuff coming up soon. But I can tell I'm getting older when you start to, like, be asked to do things like that. I do love being able to mentor and help young women. There's a lot of young women that reach out and that I stay in touch with over the years and help guide or you know, just be a sounding board. I think I was really lucky with that. I came from a family of very, very strong women who did not follow the rules. And so I, you know, was really naive in the fact that, like, a lot of women don't have that, you know, a lot of women don't have those role models or that upbringing. Whereas, like, I almost was brought up to sort of buck the system a little bit. And not everybody had that experience. And so I think as I've gotten older too, I'm really grateful for my family and the women that are in my family that sort of showed me that I could do whatever it was that I wanted to do. Yeah. So yeah, if I can even play some small role for that in young women's lives, I think that's really, really amazing.
Absolutely. Well, you're an inspiration to so many, I'm sure, across all different disciplines. Like you said, I think one of the other big bridge the gap successes I've seen from you is, and for hopefully more sports medicine practitioners out there, is that multidisciplinary approach. The idea that everybody has their expertise and nobody can understand and know it all. So you need to bring in those, you know, people that are, you know, on board with your game plan, right? The trajectory of whatever group you're working with. But they're the expert and you have to kind of refer back to them, because I don't know everything about acupuncture. I love it. I'm fascinated by it. But, you know, I need to bring people in to talk to me about some of these other, you know, mechanisms and histories and all the things that go along with it. It's beautiful.
Yeah, it really is cool.
Yeah. And, you know, for those of you out there that haven't done acupuncture or don't have acupuncturists in your network, I highly recommend you find someone in your community that you can pair with, because they are such a complementary provider. It's not contradictory to Western medicine. It is a complementary medicine practice. And unfortunately, they're 50 years behind us in the literature world, but they are like 150 years ahead of us in understanding the mind-body connection of it all. And that's the way I always try to, you know, tell people that acupuncture is not this off kind of weird voodoo magic thing. It is such important appreciation for the way the mind and the body connect. I think 20 years ago, we didn't talk about that at all in Western medicine. And now we're really talking about it. And so we have to catch up to them when it comes to the full approach of the human body and all its efficiencies that are out there. It's really, really neat stuff. So
it is.
Yeah. Yeah. So leading the charge again, Sue Falsoni. I love this conversation. It was such a good one. I hope to do another one with you in the next 6 months, because I feel like I have so many other things we could have touched on and dove into. But again, if you guys are out there looking for online education, go to Structure and Function. They have some great platforms out there. Lots of fun stuff. Any other parting words you want to say out there?
Nope. I think that's it. Just thanks so much for having me on. I love that you reached out and that we were able to connect. And everyone kind of sent some good vibes to my puppy.
Oh, there's Richard.
To Richard. but no, thanks so much for having me on. And I love these discussions. And yeah, I think there's a lot more we can talk about. So let's
absolutely. Look forward to more collaboration with you in the future, Sue.
Me too.
All right.